Here are 21 essential Slice X tips right inside of FL Studio. Let's hop straight into the DAW. We're in FL Studio 21, and the reason I use Slice X is to chop up audio and chop up drums mainly. So in your browser, you can right-click, open in new Slice X, okay, and it will automatically slice the sample. If you don't see these automatically sliced, what you could do is go to the Regions tab, go to Auto Slice, and I found medium auto slicing to be the best option. Okay, it just does the right job. So now we can play the sample, but chopped up. Okay, so we can play really cool rhythms and make melodies. Now, the first thing is auto slicing. The second thing here is this auto dump button people don't realize is on. So you could turn this off. What this means is if I go to make a melody, something simple. So if you go to your channel rack, okay, you can start doing stuff in the piano roll. Just right click, go to piano roll. Let's say you have a melody right here. Okay, just something pretty simple. Now, if you go back into Slice X and have the auto dump mode turned on, look at the piano roll here. Okay, so whenever we re-chop, okay, it will automatically overlap our melody. So it's like, what just happened to our melody? You can hit Control Z to undo that auto dump, but it's just easier to just turn off auto dump that way. Okay, so it doesn't do that. And the next thing is understanding markers. So in this little melody, let's record a better melody. Let's record it to the tempo. And okay, so that's my melody. Now let's say we like the chop, but it's just picking part of the audio that has a gap in it. So you can see in the audio goes wee, wee. Okay, there's a lot of room there, so it sounds sluggish to the ear. So what we can do is actually move these markers around. So all I have to do is now I can keep the same melody and I'm just going to move this marker to be a little closer to what's called the transient energy of the sound. Okay, so now I can play the melody. Okay, so you can get better chops and better transients that way. So that's another cool thing about Slice X. You can move your chops around over time. Now, let's say you have a chop that you just don't want. This happens a lot with drums. Sometimes it will auto slice like the air in between a hi-hat. Like right here, I might not want this whole thing to be two slices. I might want it to just be one. So this is just, to my ear, it's one slice. What you could do is just right click on the marker and delete. So now it's, you can play the whole thing without it sounding like half and half. Okay, so those were the first four tips. Now let's move into the next section, which is filtering. So by default, everything is in what's called Articulator 1. So that's what this ART stands for, Articulator 1. So all these chops by default are sent to this Articulator 1. Just think of it as a group of effects and a group of things you could change. That's all it is. So it's in group number 1. So by what we can do is actually add a filter. If you hit the X1 button, it now turns on what's called a low pass filter, or LP for low pass filter, which will chop out the high end. If you don't want that like type sound, just turn down what's called the resonance or the RES knob. We're gonna turn it up just for the purpose of the video. So most people don't know you can add filters to your chops using what's called the articulator. The next thing people skip over is the amp envelopes. Okay, so if you go to where it says envelope right here, these right here. Okay, you can also go through and select an envelope per the thing. So let's say you want to do a cutoff envelope. You can actually just turn this on. So basically, these are the things that can change: the panning, the volume, the cutoff frequency, the resonance of the filter, the speed of the sample, and the starting of the sample. And they can be controlled by these things at the bottom. They can be controlled by an envelope, a low frequency oscillator, velocity, sensitivity, the mod X thing up here, or the mod Y, or random. Okay, so what we can do is control the cutoff with an envelope, it's called. So all I have to do is turn this little button on, and now the filter will move in this motion. OK, Okay, so what also people overlook is that you can actually, now every sample is completely different. Okay, but let's say I want the melody part, this part right here. Let's say I want to change the pitch. I can double click on the marker now and then highlight this specific part of the sample. And I can go to where it says speed and I can change the pitch. So in the top left of FL, it gives me a value. Let's add 300 cents to that. Okay, so now you can hear it. Let's turn off the filter. So if you want to do little change-ups like that and get really dramatic, you can change the pitch per sample. Now, if you're going for an overall pitch change, I would recommend just going to the master pitch and then pulling this up. Every 100 cents is one note. So in this case, I'm reading the top left value. We just added 300 cents to this. So now we've raised the key three notes. Now notice the sample plays faster when we raise the pitch. Let's lower it down 300 cents and you'll notice it slows down more. So luckily the key was perfect to begin with, so we don't have to change that, but that's called the master pitch. Also, you can change the volume and the panning per slice. So again, let's go through and listen to this. Let's say we want the don't on the left. We could double click on this and then go to where it says amp. And if you read the value in the top left, it says panning, and the other one says volume to the right. So let's pan this one to the left, and let's have the we on the right. So double click on that marker and then pan this one to the right. So now we have a dynamic sample. It goes don't we. Okay, so now you can switch it up that way. That's another cool way to switch it up. The next thing is having what's called a unique output. This is a little harder to understand if you're not understanding signal flow, but long story short, when you hit Control L and send sounds to the mixer, they're accounted for in the mixer. So if I play all the sounds right now, they're all going to what's called the mixer channel number 8. But let's say we want to add like a reverb to that last chop. I'm just going to load up a random reverb. Okay. And let's say we just want like a dramatic ending. Okay. So what I can do is I can actually send certain chops over to another mixer channel. So what I'm going to do is double click on the melody part. And right here where it says out, you can left click and go negative, which means -1 from the mixer channel that you started at. In this case, everything's linked to mixer channel A by default. Now by default, everything's routed to the master if you don't route it to the mixer. So long story short, if it's in the mixer, okay, it starts at that number and now I can change the output. So if I do +1, it's now going to go to mixer channel 9. That's great for when you have a drum kit, for example, and you want to separate the snares or the hi-hats out and filter them or do some kind of work to the snares without editing everything all at once. That's a quick way to separate sounds. I found that really useful for drum kits specifically. So what most people don't understand too is that for the markers, you can actually change your snap to grid. Let's change it to snap to 0 crossings. This will prevent any clicks and pops. Okay. Now, if you're trying to get to a specific part of the sample, you can change this to snap to the grid or snap to samples. But if you're trying to prevent all clicks and pops, go to snap to 0 crossing. This will prevent the sample from clicking and popping when you move the marker to lock to that. So the geeky part is if you zoom all the way in, all this means is that the sample, let me see if I can zoom in here. All it means is that it will only lock to 0 values so that you have what's called a node, okay? So that's the geeky part of it. Okay, so that's called snap to 0 crossings. Really important for drums. In this case, it's a vocal, so you're not hearing any clicks. But if it were drums, you'd hear more of that click. Okay, so nextly, you can drag the sample selection out of Edison. So let's say you want to do something different. Let's say you want to time stretch the melody part. Let's find that sample. Here it is. So you could double click on it. And in the top right over here, it says drag copy sample selection. You could drag this straight into the playlist and do different stuff to it. So you can time stretch. It's its own thing now. If I double click, you could do stuff to it. Let's put it on stretch mode. let's time stretch it, and then let's pitch it down and just mess with it. So now it's its own thing, okay? So you can actually remove stuff out of Slice X and make it its own thing. That's really good for if you're sampling from records and you just want the vocal or you just want some snare or whatever the thing is, you could just drop it straight into the playlist like that. So let me show you some more advanced tips here. Most people don't know what this means, the random controller. So what I'll do right now is, what I'm gonna do first is turn on what's called the articulator's filter, where it says LP and then X1, this means the filter is on. Let's go to pattern mode. So you can hear that filter. But instead of controlling this filter with an envelope, what I want to do is control it randomly. So what this means is if I move this to non-linear, it will change the value of the cutoff frequency so that the filter feels like it's moving randomly. There's no set value. So it's changing every single time. I'm going to pull back the melody marker so that we can hear that one too. Okay, so it's completely random. To demonstrate this, I'm going to play it with my hand so you guys can see how sometimes it's like... Okay, so it's completely random. Okay, so you can use the random to really mess with the cutoff filter. This is a really cool effect when you have pads or more musical stuff because it gives it an emotion that's more harder to predict, which creates that human type of feel. Okay, so that random articulator is very important. Next, you can also change articulators and groups. So if you want to have that effect, but only for group number two, so let's, right here, we can switch the groups. So we have articulator group 1, 2, 3 through 8, okay? So let's say you only want that effect, but on group 2. What you can do now is go to articulator 2 and then set your low pass filter. I'm going to turn the filter off for articulator 1, but set the low pass filter here for articulator 2. Have the random mode on the envelope. And now any marker that we set to the articulator group number 2, it will get that filter effect. So here's how you assign groups. This is a little geeky, I understand. But where it says marker 10, I'm double clicking on that marker so I can select all its other parameters. And now I'm going to left click and drag this to articulator 2. So now it's part of the filter group for articulator 2. Basically, I want the filter to control this melody part. Okay, so it's random. I tried to override it just a little bit so you could hear the effect. Okay, so that's how articulator groups work. So if you only want, again, certain effects on certain chops, you can actually assign them to certain articulator groups. And there's an articulator group for the amplitude, the filter, the speed, and then the start time, which are all these things up top here. Okay, that's what that means. All these little things you could change up top. Okay, so following the notes, the next thing is de-clicking in and out of the samples. So if you click the tools icon, where is it at? You can de-click in and de-click out. What this means is if you have a really clicky vinyl type sample and it has that pop and click sound at the beginning or ending of the sample, you can click this tool icon and go to de-click in and de-click out to prevent that pop and click. But I already showed you a way earlier to prevent that, which is the snap to grid zero crossing. But let's say you have a snare that's just perfectly lined up. It just has that click in the beginning. You could double click on it and then go to de-click in and it will create what's called a crossfade or a fade in effect over the volume so that it doesn't click like that. So that's called de-click in. Now let's get into some really advanced stuff. Okay, so yeah, I knew you're ready for the advanced stuff. Let's hit Control A and let me see here. Let's go to Control A. Let's go to Format. I'm going to get rid of these markers. Let me see here. How do we get rid of these markers? Can we rid the markers? See, we just deleted it, and that's not what I want to do. Okay, so what I'm going to do is show you how to lo-fi. So right here, we have the melody chop. Let's create a lo-fi version of this. Click on this format button right here. Go to Edit Properties. And now we're going to select the number from, let's say, 8,000 and below. We're going to hit Resample, okay? And now what this will do is lower the sample rate. So let's hit Accept. said accept, and now it should play the lo-fi version. And you can hear it chops off some of those highs. Now, if you want a really exaggerated effect, let me undo. Let's see if it's still on. Okay, it still sounds on to me, so I'm going to edit and undo some of those properties. Okay, so that's the original. So now what we're going to do is go to format, edit properties. So if you really want to hear an exaggerated effect, you can type in 1,000 or 2,000, hit resample, hit accept. And now it's the Drake underwater sound. Okay, so that's how you do the super, super lo-fi effect. That's for more advanced folks who really want to take it to that level. Okay, so let's say you have a drum kit, and I just grabbed a random loop from FL Studio. Okay, you go to regions, auto slice, medium auto slicing, so everything's automatically chopped. Okay, so it's automatically chopped. But let's say you want to make a drum kit out of these chops. How do you do it? Once you have your marker set, you can actually go to where it says save, and then export regions for common use. Okay, I'm just going to put this on my desktop somewhere. We're just going to say test. Okay, and now I can go into that folder. And now I have individual one shots from each marker. You now have your own drum kit. So long story short, what you do is you find drum breaks or a drum take anywhere. Okay, you sample it, run it through Slice X, and then you could export each one shot to have your own drum kit that you could just program just like you would any other drums. Okay, so I'm keeping track just so I don't go off on tangents. Nextly, we want to edit the free smooth edit button. So this is a little advanced. So I'm pulling up a snare here for you to understand this. Whenever you edit something, you could turn off what's called the smooth button. So if you click the scissors here, where it says edit, and it says click free smooth editing, I'm going to turn it off, and I'll show you why. Because when you open up a pointy sound like a snare, for example, and then we right click and edit in the audio editor, what we're actually doing when we have that click free smooth, editing, it's also under here and click free smooth editing. Okay, so what does this mean? So now look at the beginning of the snare. I'm going to highlight it and I'm going to delete it. So look at the pointy, look how pointy the snare is. Okay, it's very pointy. Now I'm going to hit Control, Delete, and look, it creates this fade. It might be harder for beginners to see it, but it creates a fade of volume, which actually makes the snare go, and it just doesn't sound as pointy and harsh. Okay, so we don't want to use that click-free smooth editing because in this case, I simply wanted to chop off the beginning of the snare. I didn't want to create a fade. Okay, so this is very important for people who are creating drum kits. So long story short, click on the edit button, turn click free smooth editing off. So now when I chop this off of the snare, it's exactly what I'm chopping off of the snare. It's not going to create that inner fade like it did before. Okay, so that's a very minute detail, but for people who sound design and make drum kits, that's for you. Next, let's talk about layering the samples. So I believe I did it on one of these. Let me find it. So a lot of people don't know, you actually have two tape decks. Okay, so you have deck A and then deck B. And if you click this little drop down button, you can actually layer both decks. Okay, so on deck A, I just dragged in the audio. Deck B, I left clicked and dragged in the audio onto this little timeline. And then once they're both on there, you can go to here, go to layer both decks. So what does that mean? It means it's going to play a chop for both sounds and not just one or the other. My bad, I was messing with stuff. Let me turn that off. So it's actually playing both samples at that specific marker timing. Okay, so that's how you get really unique chops that nobody can emulate because you're literally layering two samples over top of each other and you have unique markers per slice. So if you want to take it to the ultimate level, that's how you take it to the ultimate level. I have two more tips and then we'll wrap this video. So we have the Mod X and Mod Y. So again, the things up top can be controlled by other stuff: the panning, the volume, the cutoff, the resonance, the speed, and the start time of the sample. So let's say we want to move the cutoff filter around. We're going to click on the cutoff filter for articulation group one. We're going to turn the filter on. And then let's say I want the mod X to control the filter. Okay, so this means when I move this thing left and right horizontally, it controls the filter amount. So I'm going to let this sample play. I think I have a sample loaded up. If not, then we're going to draw one in. Let's record. Okay, so now we have that. So what I can do now is go in, and let's say you want to perform this using the Mod X as like a movement, a life element. So I'm just left-clicking and dragging. And you can record that. So if you record notes in automation, it will record you moving this. Let's do it again. Notice I'm doing a diagonal, so it's slower, more gradual. Okay, so now we have that. It records all those movements. You can also have the mod Y control something. So let's have the mod Y control the panning or something. So it has like a stereo effect. Let's open up the cutoff a little bit. Okay, so now you can see how complex you can take this stuff. Now the last thing I'll show you here is a little more advanced, but it depends on the sample. Here we have what's called the speed. Okay, so you can select this and create an envelope. This slows or speeds up the sample. So this is how you get that scratch effect. Oh, you can't hear because the filter. Let me turn that off. So if you want to create little DJ scratches, you could do that. Okay, so it's just emulating the movement of somebody slowing down a record like that. You could change the envelope to create different effects. Okay, we could do this way. So now it has like a tape stop effect. Or you could do... add a point in here. Now I'm doing this with my left hand, so bear with me. We could do a speed up. Now this ain't working the way I expected. There we go. You would have to finesse it to figure out how to do the speed up effect. Okay, but I showed you how to do that DJ scratch effect. So I didn't have the best timing on that one. That one's a little more difficult to program in. But the last thing here is under the cog icon, go to the wrench tool. You could turn up what's called portamento, and this creates a pitch bend between slices, and it creates that really laxed type feel. Okay, so let me turn off the mod Y panning, because right now it's panned to our left ear and it sounds weird. Okay, so again, so now it's pitch bending between each slice, and it creates this slurry type of effect. So you have mastered Slice X. Go out there and make some dope beats. If you want to learn more about beat making, go to busyworksbeats.com/beatmagic. If you want to jump into all our courses, we have 60 plus music production courses. Go to premium.busyworksbeats.com. If you're new here, I need you to subscribe on YouTube, like the video, and share with a friend. Peace out, guys.